And that was on which building?
This was on a Salesforce building, 350 Mission Street.
Near
5 years ago.
Near Twitter building?
Correct. Literally like a two buildings block, there's Twitter. Exactly. And that's why we also use Twitter data real time. So what you see is a very, I mean, again, for me, it was the pioneer moment, because exploring this idea with SOM, you know, one of the most leading architects still of San Francisco, and the people from, you know, tech world really welcomed the idea of using data as a pigment and abstracting data in the form of sculpture. So this project just grew to many steves, and you see the frame idea, 2011, the frame, we couldn't do it. It comes a lot back in time, but this time in a different context. So so that's how we started, I guess, the journey. And then from there, we've just visualized flight networks of an airport, like every single flight and airport connection, you know, in the airports, luggage change, gate change, like things that can be in different scale. So if you look at our work, you will see a lot of like real time and a frozen data sculptures and paintings, which we are doing pretty much all over the world. Like, but always try to think about the function of an architecture and try to imagine how can we enhance the built environments and how can we talk about these concepts in a way that opens the mind of the audience. Just, you know, that kind of a world of imagination.
Especially in an airport. I really want your artwork at Istanbul Grand Airport.
Yes, we discussed several times, but I wish that happens with the data from the airport, because that will be really very inspiring. By the way, we also visualize invisible signals of Wi-Fi, LTE, 5G, Bluetooth. So like invisible world of data is, I think, the obsession, to be honest.
Right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of data. We are surrounded with data. We don't know what to do with data.
Exactly. And I think what really also transformed our practice is another collector from Boston in this building in Saint-Pierre. They were looking for a painting. And I said, oh, perfect time. In 2012, I started speculating the question, can data become a pigment? And thanks to Casey Rias, one of my heroes as well, he was also teaching us processing, and I was able to program my first data sculptures and paintings by using wind and temperature, some environmental data. And then I created my first actually data painting back in 2016, commissioned by a collector. So then become a part of also a private collections with wind data painting. It may be the first wind data painting in a collection in the world. So what we see is the wind direction, temperature, pressure of air transforming the particle fields, and they are transforming into these paintings.
You did something for Miami as well.
Correct. Just recently, a major installation in a private home in Miami, Dubai, Seoul, London, Chicago, New York, San Francisco, Auckland, Milano. Barcelona, like there are some pieces all over the world at the moment using different wind data. But I think what is really inspiring for me is not just the data as something like abstraction, but it has like a really logic. So what we invented in a way that, as you see, the data is really like creating the surfaces. So I think for me, like now almost 8 years, like programming this logic is where I think the movement of this idea started. Now I'm seeing many people doing a very similar stuff. But just to show you how it started is this world of imagination. And this wind of Istanbul, if you want to go to Ferko, we have also a piece in Istanbul visualizing the Istanbul's...
It's permanent, right? At Ferko building.
It's a permanent piece as well, exactly. You're right. But I think I want to show you something completely different also. We also work with the...
One question related to Istanbul wind or the wind data. Is this, yes. Ongoing, it's live? These are live sculptures? The data is updating?
No. No, this one is a frozen one, 2017. We collected from the Atatürk airport, but we have pieces like in Dubai at the moment. Is literally doing the similar thing in a real time in Dubai. It's a live piece. In Seoul, we have a live version. So different cities, different times, exploring different concepts. In Singapore, we are opening a one, for example, also with the real time wind data patterns. In Auckland, we also have a sensor we embedded to the building that sense the weather real time, the pressure, the rain, the temperature, the wind, the gush, all like transformative art. So, and this, we have the, I mean, since my hometown, Bosphorus is another project that we exhibited because of AI in the work, we were able to get the surface level activity of the Marmara Sea and transform it into a simulation of a water in the form of a data sculpture, and then transform into this experience that exhibited last year as well. So I'm very into simulations, the simulation of nature, and I'm obsessed with this, you know, fluid dynamics since, I don't know, 2012 maybe, like last 8 years, constantly imagining with the, you know, the patterns of movement in the fluids, and, you know, run them with data is my, I think, aesthetics, like a signature imagination, and apply to other places, the Black Sea, like in California, we are applying a different one. But I want to share something very quickly. When I think about these computer graphics, they are not just a bunch of demos, by the way. They are not available things that people, I mean, you can do by softwares. We use really complex software, custom algorithms that I'm hesitant to share because I have copycats and I get a little bit more offended by sharing too much, but just want to say you more is 2017, because of, I think, our works that applied pioneer computational thinking. This is another collector of our studio, Jensen Hong, who is NVIDIA CEO. And NVIDIA is a company behind GPU, I mean, graphical processor units in the computers. And they are the leading company in the world transforming the AI landscape, drivers, cars, robots, and so on. And he started collaborating with us 2017, collecting, and then also helping us. Like we have 200 GPUs in the studio, we have supercomputers, and we work with them very directly to understand the future of computer graphics, future of simulations, AI. So thanks to him, now all these artworks are actually real time. You ask this question. So that's how we do real time things. 2018, even before George Lucas, we were able to use an algorithm to like transform real time graphics by using that. May I jump to a project that I think can be also inspiring about the AI collaborations?
Sure.
So, I mean, as you may guess, like the more we did projects in San Francisco, in the US, the tech giants were getting a lot of attention to what we are doing. But I think the most important one for me was 2016. There was an amazingly important event happened in San Francisco called Deep Dream. So Deep Dream was an event, an auction, an open auction of AI artworks. But those artworks are not done by an artist. They were done by the engineers at Google. So if you remember, maybe you remember this image. Let's go here. Do you remember this image, anyone? 2016, this was one of the first AI image talking about hallucination. What you see here is an AI learn how to see the world through the lens of animal photos. Imagine a baby or a human that only learned how the animals looks like. And when you show that baby a world, that world is built up by the same context of what he or she learned. So similar concept, right? Which is called inception in their own language. But this algorithm was my first inspiration seeing, and they are the people who also did the event called Deep Dream. The same event, but I want to very quickly share this quickly. And the event was focusing on AI and how AI can be used creatively. But I was much more inspired by other concepts of thinking about ramification. So when we talk about AI, you cannot just fancification of like some bunch of algorithms doing cool things. AI means you have ethics, because AI means that there's a machine doesn't forget. But look at all these events happen just between 17 and 18. Or you remember this machine called Google Glass, right? A glass that is supposed to be the future of augmented reality, right? But what happened was something else. So it didn't work as the imagination of the machine, the people's reaction were different. So technically, if you think about flying car in a city, it looks like a little bit science fiction. But if you look at 2017, when I was starting my residency, this machine got the approval from the city of San Francisco. At the meantime, the machines assisting us, right? Cortana, Alexa, and Siri, and many on. And also the question was started, really, who owns the data in social media? I mean, many tech giants were literally playing with our data and monetizing it very openly and turning them into a value and make prediction engines. So, but at the meantime, there were much smart people and doing things very beautifully and in a very creative way, such as DeepMind. So DeepMind was going to the other direction. They were trying to create events and ideas and objects and platforms, softwares that can play the game as a concept. And by reinforcement learning algorithms or many other exciting ways, they were inventing smart and open-minding approach. There are also great professors and academics trying to make a material that can compute. Neuroscientists were predicting the human toes 11 seconds before. And Elon Musk, this weird Neuralink project, as we all know, download and upload from brain will be possible very soon. That all happened at the same time. So don't get me wrong, but it's not just, it wasn't like a very quick something to do. It was just a naturally growth idea. So anyways, Blaise Aguirre-Arcas is the person behind the program who allowed me to be one of the first artists in residence. And this is Mike Taika from Google, who allowed me and my team to learn how to use AI in 2016, like 4 years ago. Believe me, it was a lot of unique stuff going on. So my idea was using a machine consciousness, like a human can use a consciousness model. And to make it happen, inspired from Ladder of Babel, an amazing book and a story that I heavily advise you to read. And then I just changed the concept was for me was like, what will happen if we take AI and bring into a library, an archive, and let a human to watch as a performance, a machine learns in front of you. And when it learns, it gives you what it learned and you can explore the mind of a machine. And this archive can also dream because it knows what is real, right? So the whole thing was one of the first world's AI-driven artwork that triggered many projects in the world. So what we did is very simply take the data of 1.8 million images and use neural networks to analyze every single image and then take this information from latent space. Please bear with me. When AI learns data, it doesn't store in this three-dimensional world like we have, right? When we go to a library, you open a book, you just have this table. But when AI learns, it stores data in a mathematical space called latent space, which can be 10 to 24 dimension. How on earth we can perceive something we cannot see, right? So then I started using an algorithm called TSNE 2016 and transformed this high level dimension data into a three dimensional, four dimensional, six dimensional universe. So what you see here is also, I think, the world's first data sculpture using AI's outputs in 2016 and 17. But that's how we started to use also these lower dimension reduction algorithms. And I think these are like very early steps of it. So at the end, the artwork turned into an immersive environment, traveled many cities. But I want to show you something much interesting. Excuse me?
You did something for Salt Library in Istanbul too.
Yes, this was a Salt. This was a Salt project. This was. Mm-hmm. This is from the Salt archives. What we are seeing. So the good news is, I think 2016 also started using GAN algorithms. So GAN algorithm is a kind of a very exciting generative adversarial network algorithm. So when I was doing a study at Google, there was a wonderful person called Ian Goodfellow, who is the inventor of the algorithm. And I was very fortunate to start a very early baby step. So what you are seeing is 4 years ago. I mean, imagine 4 years ago, right? Like it's just a lot of, a big step in between time, we were able to train our neural network with this data. So what does this mean? Of course, you can create this, you know, GANwalk, which is basically you train the machine with this information, and then you can make these movements in the mind of a machine. So which then later on turns into other artworks that you will see later. So this is like a very early first things and example of doing that. So, but I think the project you ask is Melting Memories, right, Aileen, which I would like to share quickly as well, before the questions maybe. This project was really exciting. This is a moment when I learned that my uncle was Alzheimer's, 2017. But being working with AI also allowed me to like ask the questions much brave and say, what will happen if I touch our memories? Like, can we talk with them? Can we touch them? Can they remember better or eventually them learn better? So thanks to the UCSF, University of California, San Francisco, Adam Gesley as the amazing neuroscientist and his lab at San Francisco allowed me and my team to learn how to use complex EEG data, or two-channel EEG data, and use AI to find the pattern, the moment of remembering, and transform that electric signal into a data sculpture and data painting. So the project was really very inspiring for me, also changed my thinking. Got a Lorenzo Lifetime Award from the Florence Biennale last year, and was in Pompidou Museum as well. And also got many recognition from the art, science, and technology communities because we developed a tool at the end, not just fancy images. There's a tool that the scientists can use. A scientist can, you know, explore data as well. This was the Turkey's most visited exhibition called Melting Memories.
I brought my...
So this is what we are watching, is the moment of remembering, transforming into the form of a data sculpture.
Now one question, the music with you, imitating or repeating some format?
Yes. Yes. So pretty much every music you hear is also driven by data. They are not just compositions. Some of them even driven by AI, because of our recent research on the last 3 years, working with Google's also residency, I was able to create also work with AI's imagination of, you know, compositions as well. But every time you hear a music, most likely from the data projects, they're also driven by the same data that we are hearing. So just want to very quickly explore one more project. So the GAN algorithms and the NVIDIA's collaboration with our studio allow us to use algorithms way before anyone can reach. These are one of the best algorithms in the world that allows you to like create a cutting edge AI research. But for me, the boring part, why do we use faces? Like, why are we using someone's very personal data? In fact, why don't we use our collective memories, such as, you know, space, ISS telescope, Hubble telescope, Mars? Why don't we use nature? Why don't we use the buildings of the streets, the trees, the flowers, the things doesn't belong to one person, but it belongs to humanity. So I started Mission Hallucination 2016, right after the archive dreaming, and last 4 years, constantly training AI algorithms with the buildings, sometimes like really, these are custom software, by the way.
This is spectacular.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So what we are seeing here is also we develop a custom software, which is recognized in SIGGRAPH and GTC and many other NVIDIA events in the computer graphics community. We developed a software that allows me to really create those dreams. So imagine that you are in the mind of a machine, what it learned. On the right side, I select an image and then I go somewhere else, right? From the building's facade to the interior. And I let machine to hallucinate an environment in between. So that is, I'm calling it latent cinema. A technique that I think we pioneered it last 3 or 4 years now. This whole thing is a latent space exploration, is one of our fresh approach to the field of AI and arts. And I applied to Frank Gehry, Zaha Hadid, Tadao Ando, Toyo Ito, and 2 years ago, 2018 winter, we were invited to become a NASA GPL Studios collaborator. So last 2 years, we are working with NASA GPL archives. So the Mars data, right? One of the most inspiring space, I think maybe it's our next home. So these are not real Mars photos, but what you see here, also three-dimensional sculptures. So since 2018, we are also speculating three-dimensional sculptures, which also inspired many people, and copycats are doing the same thing in some ways. You will see them a lot. But these all ideas coming from here. So like we take the data from AI, the colors, the movements, and even create those, you know, other level of data paintings and data sculptures in three dimensions and so on. ISS and machine, data.
Machine combines them, brings them as images.
Correct. So yes. So our very big challenge here is how we can use AI to look at the patterns of information in the mind of a machine. And as you know, I'm obsessed with fluid dynamics. We are combining that universes. So that's a signature thinking of behind those, you know, algorithms. And this is a project in New York, the similar idea, but this time still of New York. These images are not real. None of them are real. They are all machine hallucinations. So we train neural network with 113 million images of New York that are not real. And then we call it machine hallucination. So if you see this, a three-dimensional boiler room in Chelsea Market. Sorry?
These are pictures of New York City.
Correct. Photos of New York transformed into added dream landscapes by using AI and cutting-edge computer graphics. We had here 18 projectors per two-channel sound of the, So this is kind of one of the, I think, complex transformation of a gallery or a museum into something else. So I'm really very happy about this project as well, because we did a very similar thing in Berlin in Kraftwerk, transformed the just last year, the power plant Kraftwerk, 6 years of Kraftwerk into a three-dimensional light and data sculptures using lasers, transforming three-dimensional neural networks and so on. So it was a really, really very exciting time for our studio. And lastly, maybe the last project, the Frank Gehry's Disney Hall. Should I share this?
Beautiful. This is
Frank Gehry's building in Los Angeles, coming back to 2018.